Good morning and welcome to Hosanna Fellowship. To all our guests and visitors, I extend a very warm welcome. This morning we'll be exploring the topic, Validity of the Bible. Through that we use a fusion of creative arts such as dance, drama, song, music, multimedia and the spoken word. Next up we have an opportunity for you to participate, so if you could all stand, put your hands together for Shine.
Good morning. I trust that you're a bit warmed up now, yeah? Awesome. Okay, I'm just going to run through a couple of announcements. Right now, there's going to be a couple of buckets passing down the aisles. If you're visiting with us this morning, we don't expect you to put anything in the bag. This is a time where Hosanna loves to give to God. So just sit back during this time. Now, also, if you're visiting us, we've got a card for you to fill in. If you're interested in finding out more about us, feel free to grab one of these cards. They're just available in the front foyer. Fill it in and then pop it in the box and we'll be in contact with you during the week. Also, next week, we've got something very exciting coming up. It's called When My Relationship Is Failing. Now, I'm sure we've experienced this all at times. So feel free to come back next week, 6:30 p.m. here at Hosanna. Bring your friends and family along. That's another creative arts service. Now, let's move along with our program. We have got a dance coming up. So can you please put your hands together and welcome on the dance team.
I have some words for you to consider. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and the spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart.
You believe? Oh, if you don't, it's okay. You're in the right place. Because, I truly do believe. And I'm preparing for this message today. I believe in more, you know? It's like, and I think it'll come across by the time I finish speaking today that I do. But if you don't, that's fine. It's just great that you're here. And maybe you might change your mind by the end of the day. The validity of the Bible, it's an incredible subject because, you know, in preparing for a message, it's not like, what do you put in? It's like, what do you leave out? You know, we live in an information age where just everything is at our fingertips through the internet. And just during the week, I've been, you know, just push a couple of buttons and I can look at a fragment of the Bible from the first century, just like that, the photograph of it. And there's all that information that you need is there. So I'm going to talk about some stuff today, but I'm really aware of the fact that we don't have that much time. So some of the things that I'm going to say, you may not be sure about. I'd challenge you to go away and research it yourself. And if you want some information at the end, my information at the end, come and see me and I'll go and get some for you. I'll give you my what I've got. Does that sound like a good idea? Don't take my word. Find out for yourself. Well, this is what Napoleon said about the Bible. He said it's no mere book, it's a living creature. A living creature with a power that conquers all that oppose it. That's the words of a military man. It's not much different to the word that was read out by Jenny today, though, that comes out of the Bible, the book of Hebrews. It's alive. And the way you experience it, the fact that it's alive, is by reading it yourself and applying it to your life. It's a book that has one integrated design. There are 66 books that make up the Bible. There's 40 different writers. But the Christians claim, or we claim, that there's only one author, which is very interesting. All scripture is God-breathed and is used for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, according to Paul, and writing in 2 Timothy there. And there's one unfolding theme throughout the Bible, which is the redemption of mankind. And it's written over a period of, they're not sure, but at least 1,500 years and more. So how am I going to demonstrate the validity of the Bible? Well, there's three ways. The first way is to look at whether or not the Bible is a historically reliable document. That's the first way. The second way would be to kind of have a look at the archaeological evidence, and we have a lot of it from this century, the finds, the digs that have been done around the Middle East, and to see if that backs up what the Bible says. And the third way is a little bit more interesting, a bit more challenging, and that is, if God was going to communicate a message to his creation, let's assume that he's the creator, if he wanted to communicate a message to us, how would he do that? And I'm going to propose a couple of theories, a couple of ways that he might do that. So first of all, let's go to the first one. Is the Bible historically reliable? Well, let's first look at the manuscripts. That's what you do if you're looking at a historical document to see if it's reliable, whether it be Christian or non-Christian, biblical or non-biblical. And what the historians will do, they'll look at how many manuscripts, how many copies of the original article are there. And for the Bible, we have over 24,000 manuscripts, partial and full manuscripts. They're not all like the Bible. They're not all like this. Some of them are little bits of paper, fragments of paper. There are 24,000 of them. They're all catalogued, and they're all available to look at on the net. How does that look like? How does that compare with other books in history? Well, if we go to the next closest book in history, which is called Iliad by Homer, that's how many copies we've got the Bible, relative, compared to the next copy book in history. So you can see the Bible, there's quite a lot of stuff there to work from. And the other thing that the historians will look at, they'll say, well, okay, so there's a lot of manuscripts, but how close to the original are the copies? And that gives real weight to the document. And for the Bible, it's incredible. You know, some people, the skeptics used to say that, you know, there's nothing available from, you know, until the 3rd or 4th century or something like that, which is rubbish. And scientifically now, they can clearly prove that some of the fragments that clearly validate the Bible that we have here today are within a few decades of the times, you know, when the apostles were going around spreading the things that they've written. And you can have a look at those on the net too. And let me ask you a question. If I was to say to you, do you think the document between the white settlers and the Tangata Whenua? The treaty. Gosh, talk about the Treaty of Waitangi. I think we're going back 160, 170 years. 1840 it was, something like that. It was written. Do we believe that it's a real document? Oh, I do. I don't know about you. Is it? Of course it is, you know. And like, for example, this century, do we believe that the Holocaust happened? Because we know some people don't. You know, kind of perpetrate the lie that nobody was killed, you know. It was all good. It was all sweet in Auschwitz. How they come up with that, I don't know. But we accept that it's true. Well, of course, we have photographs and that now. But the documents are there. And, you know, for the early church leaders, it was exactly the same. They had all those documents available to them. They didn't question them. So we have got lots of manuscripts. We've got a short time delay between the originals and the copies. We've got biased authors, though. I mean, if you accept that the manuscripts might be okay and not doctored, what about the authors? You know, they could have just got together, the four of them, especially the four writers of the Gospels, and collaborated and come up with a story, and they could have just made all the things that were said were going to happen in the Old Testament happen. You know, they could have just written that those things had happened, they hadn't happened. Yeah, I'm not very convincing at that, but the reality is, we know that what they wrote was true, because who would testify a lie to die? Now, we have martyrs in the world today that really believe strongly about what they're doing, and they kill people, and they believe they're going to paradise, and they're going to be okay. And they believe so strongly what they believe that they're prepared to die. The thing about the authors of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is that they were telling the story of what they had experienced and seen. So for them to be martyred, they would actually have to be lying about what they saw. Then that would be pretty stupid, wouldn't it? Of course, they could have said, oh, no, it was a lie. I don't want to die. I don't want to get crucified. I don't want to be put in boiling oil. You know, the way that these people died. Of course, all the apostles died, except for, well, Judas died, but he wasn't killed. Except for John. Who would do that? Who would die for a lie? I mean, it's just not logical. So, in my mind at least, I believe that their evidence, their witness, their testimony is credible. But then you've got unbiased authors as well. You've got historians around the time who weren't part of the whole Christian scene, but who witnessed things that were going on. And I want to read to you a little bit about what Josephus said. This is what he said. Josephus was a Pharisee. If you were here last week, you know how Jesus spoke to the Pharisees. So there was no love lost between Jesus and the Pharisees. But anyway, Josephus wrote this about Jesus. Now there was about this time Jesus, a wise man, if it be lawful to call him a man, for he was a doer of wonderful works, a teacher of such men as received the truth with pleasure. He drew over to him both many of the Jews and many of the Gentiles, the non-Jews. He was the Christ. And when Pilate, at the suggestion of the principal men amongst us, had condemned him to the cross, those that loved him at first did not forsake him. Well, we know that to be true because they died, because they didn't forsake him. For he appeared to them alive again, and the third day, as the divine prophets had foretold, these and 10,000 other wonderful things concerning him. And the tribe of Christians so named from him are not extinct to this day. And we can validate that, can't we? That's just one historian writing about the time, about Christians and about Jesus. And what a witness. It's incredible. What about the church leaders? Do you know that we have 32,000 quotations from the early church leaders, first couple of centuries, quotations of their writings, quotations from the Bible. And we have copies of those. Just to give you a few of those people, among them are Clement, 30 to 95 AD, Polycarp, 70 to 156 AD, Ignatius, 70 to 110 AD. You know, from the documents of the early church leaders, these are just a few of them, you could just about write the New Testament. Just from the quotations. Does that validate the Bible? I think probably it's quite weighty. What about archaeology? Does archaeology validate the Bible? Well, here's Nelson Kluick. He's a well-known archaeologist, many finds. He's there in Time magazine. This is what he said. He said, as a matter of fact, however, it may be clearly stated categorically that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a single biblical reference. Some of archaeology's findings have been made, scores of archaeological findings have been made which confirm in clear outline or exact details historical statements in the Bible. And you can access that information real quick. There is a lot of stuff that's been found that absolutely validates the events, the times, and the people that the Bible writes about. But what about the most credible find that we've had this century? And it's got to be this one. It's the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, the Dead Sea Scrolls were found in 1947. There was a Bedouin boy. He threw a stone into a cave looking for his sheep. This is the story. Smashed a clay pot. He heard the clay pot smash. So he went into the cave. and he found all of a whole lot of clay pots full of scrolls. Now, because they were in the cave, because they were in the clay pot, because they were in the desert, these parchments and scrolls, some of them were on a thing called papyrus, which only lasted a couple of hundred years, but others were on skin, animal hide. They were incredibly good shape. And in there is a scroll of Isaiah. It's about 75% complete, which absolutely validates the book of Isaiah that I'm reading from today. Now, that document is B.C. They date the documents in there from around 200 B.C. to sometime in the first century. Man, that says something incredible about the copyist or the scribes, the people that, you know, because you've got to keep writing the Bible, the material they were using in the day didn't last. That says something incredible about how seriously they took their job, how professional they were. Absolutely. Adds a lot of weight to the Bible that we have today. And then, of course, we have the Ebola tablets. Now, these tablets were found somewhere. Let's have a look here. They are from about 1,000 years before the time of Moses. Right? And they're tablets, so no problem reading them because they're clay tablets. And it's kind of like the city library of Ebla, of everything that happened at the time. And what it does is it confirms places, names, around the time of the patriarchs in the book of Genesis. So it too adds incredible weight to the Bible. It doesn't quote the Bible, it doesn't say the same things, but it paints a picture of what was happening, you know, 2,000 to 3,000 years ago, which very, very accurately corroborates the sort of information that was given in the Bible. So they're just a couple of archaeological things that add heaps of weight to the Bible. Now I want to talk about something. I want to challenge us to think about how God might communicate to people to kind of authenticate this message in the Bible. Sorry. And to do that, we want to look at some scientific stuff. Because, you know, to be a Christian and to believe the Bible, you don't have to throw your brain out. You know, like throwing the baby out with the bathwater. You don't have to do that. Let's talk about time for a bit. Talk about gravitational time dilation. I'm taking this stuff from Chuck Missler, who you can hear on Radio Rima. I'm stealing some of his stuff here today, so I just thought I'd better say that. I don't want to be head up for plagiarism or anything. I'm sure Chuck won't mind. We've got identical atomic clocks located at the National Bureau of Standards in Boulder, Colorado, and the Royal Observatory in Greenwich, England. Both are correct to better than a millionth of a second per year. The NBS clock ticks 5 millionths of a second faster than the identical clock in Greenwich. These are identical clocks. Now, why is that? How can that be? These are clocks that they don't go slow, they don't go fast. You know, these are clocks that are accurate to absolute. I don't have the details. Very accurate. Why could this happen? Both are correct. But it happens because of this. Boulder, Colorado is at 5,400 feet altitude. And Greenwich, England's at 80 feet altitude. Now, what is the significance of that? Well, the significance of that is that gravity affects time. It's demonstrable, and I'll show you some demonstrations here. If you raise an atomic clock up a meter, they speed up by 10 to the negative 16. Something per meter. I've missed something out there. They speed up. You lift the clock up, it speeds up. Atomic clock, it speeds up. There was an aircraft experiment done in 1971 by a couple of guys called Hathaway and Keating. They both sent four caesium clocks around the world. Now, these are very accurate clocks. They sent one east and they sent one west. The one that went eastward, as you can see there, lost 1.059 microseconds. The one that went westward gained 0.273 microseconds. How could that be? Well, all it did was it confirmed the theory of relativity that Einstein gave us, and it showed that time is relevant to gravity mass, and velocity. Are you starting to be challenging your thinking? Is this new to some of you? What about this one? Hopefully this will blow your mind. Twin astronauts. Hypothetical people, these. They're born at the same time. They're both astronauts. One gets to travel to the closest star to Earth. That's where we are, eh? I got some serious brain problems this morning. Please bear with me, eh? Here's the calculation to use, right? So we got TE and we got TS here. If they go 50%, if the one astronaut goes to Alpha Centauri, the closest star to the Earth, at 50% the speed of light, right? It's a 9-year trip there, a 9-year trip back, 18 years round trip. For him, the trip takes 15 years, 3 months. When he comes back, he's 2 years, 9 months younger than his twin. Can you believe that? I'm telling you, it's true. It's absolutely true. You're starting to be challenged in your thinking. We exist in more than three dimensions, provable. Time itself is a physical property. Time varies with mass, acceleration, and gravity. And some of those examples there demonstrated that. Now, how does that fit in with my message today? Well, I want to suggest that if God wanted to communicate with his creation, he may do that through a mechanism that would prove that he's actually outside the restrictions of time. Now, how would he do that? Let me go a little bit further. Have a look at eternity. Now, we're taught in school when we're young that eternity sort of starts on the left and there's a linear line that goes to the right. Okay? That's kind of how we think of eternity. Eternity is not like that at all. Eternity is actually existing outside of time altogether. Is God subject to gravity? I doubt it. Is he constrained to the limits of mass and acceleration? Hardly. Well, if that's so, he's outside of time altogether. From outside of time, this is what God says in Isaiah. For this saith, and I'm using the King James thing here because, just forgive the old English. For this saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity. That's God's abode. That's where he lives. If we look at the geometry of eternity, it might look something like this. We have a timeline there, and we have the past, the present, and the future. God's out there in eternity, and for us, we see events that happen in time, they unfold before us over time. Does that make sense? God sees those events all at the same time. Now, how does that affect what I'm talking about today? I'm getting there. If he wanted to get a message to us, how would he authenticate it? One way is that he could give us the message before it was going to happen. We kind of call that we call that prophecy, predicting the future. This is what Einstein said about time. People like us who believe in physics know that the distinction between the past, the present, and the future is only a stubbornly persistent illusion. And God's not... Well, this is what God says. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what's still to come. And he does it through prophecy. And prophecy is one of the ways that God can communicate to us to let us know what's going to happen, what's coming up in the future. Right. We're going to look at a couple of prophecies now. And we're going to see how God has done this. Listen to Zechariah 9:9. Says, rejoice greatly. This is long before the time of the coming of Jesus. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation. Gentle and riding on a donkey. On a colt, the foal of a donkey. And I'm going to show you in a minute when this prophecy came true. If we look at another prophecy here, it says this in Daniel 9:25. This is called the 69 weeks. And this is one of the most amazing prophecies in the Old Testament. No one understands this: from the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed one, the ruler, comes, there will be seven sevens and 62 sevens. Now, it's believed the anointed one was the Messiah that the Jews were expecting to come to save them from all their strife. Now, did that happen? Let's have a look at this. There's a book that was written by Sir Robert Anderson, The Coming Prince, and it talks about this prophecy, and he did a lot of work, and he did it with the help of the Royal Observatory. And I'm not going to quote this to you as fact. What I'm giving to you this today is to challenge your thinking. I believe it personally, and a lot of people who work in this field do as well. There was a commandment to store Jerusalem. When did that happen? Well, in Nehemiah 2, in the Old Testament, there was a decree of that guy there on the March 14th, 445 BC, that they would start to rebuild Jerusalem. All right, we know that. It's in the Bible. Now, the 69 times 7 times 360 is so many days. The 69, if we have a look back at the it says there will be seven sevens and 62 sevens. Now, we consider a week to be 7 days. The sevens talked about here are years, okay? So what it's actually saying is, quite clearly, that will be 69, if we add those two together, 62 and 7, there'll be 69 weeks of years, which is 69 times 7 years. And the calendar at the time was 360 days per year. If you calculate it out, you get that many days to the coming of the Messiah. That's basically what the prophecy was saying. It was saying, and this amount of time, this is what's believed was being said, in this amount of time, the Messiah, the King, is going to come. Well, we have an event that happened around that time. And I want to talk about that now. It's found in Luke 19, 38 to 40. This is what there's some more calculations there. If you want to know and research this yourself, go to the book. Get the details and go to the book. Blessed is the King, it says. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now, this happened when Jesus sent his disciples into Jerusalem to get a donkey to bring to him so that he could ride into Jerusalem on a donkey to fulfill the prophecy that we heard earlier in Zechariah 9:9 that said that he would come on the foal of a donkey. All right? So that's actually happening here. Jesus is setting it up, and he starts riding into Jerusalem on this donkey. And his disciples start praising and they start singing out this, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now, what the people, the Pharisees, the other people there knew was what they were doing. They were quoting Psalm 118. And what that relates to is the coming again of the Messiah, the King. So basically what they were doing was blasphemous. And it wasn't a good thing to do back then, okay? And then it goes on. I tell you, he replied. Oh, sorry. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, teacher, rebuke your disciples, because he wanted them to stop them saying what they were saying. It was blasphemous. I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. This is a big event that's happening here. As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another. Now that happened in 70 AD. Jerusalem, over 100 million women, men and children were just killed. And Titus, the emperor, went in and basically destroyed it. They took the whole thing apart because there was so much gold in the temple. They took every stone apart so they could get the gold out of the temple. So that prophecy there came to pass. But what does he say next? Because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. And that's the point I'm trying to make here. Jesus is clearly saying there, I'm here. I've come. I'm fulfilling Zechariah 9:9, which said that he would come on a donkey, the foal of a colt. He's fulfilling the prophecy that was said about him in Daniel 9:25 that actually gave, according to some people, the amount of days it would take before he would turn up. pretty weighty prophecies, these, about the coming of, as we see there, God. And that's the other way. If you were God and you want to communicate to your creation, why not just turn up? Why not just tell a whole lot of people along the way? We call prophets, have them recorded in the Old Testament so people know what's coming, and then turn up. You see, because what happened is, we're talking about the authentication of Christ here. We've got Daniel 69 weeks that I talked about just then. We've also got over 300 other detailed, specific prophecies about the coming of the Messiah and what would happen. Details about Jesus, his life and times, and how he would die and that he would rise again. And these detailed prophecies come, we have the Septuagint, which was a Greek translation of the Old Testament Bible that was written 200 to 300 years before Christ came. So this stuff wasn't written afterwards. And then we have, this is one of the detailed prophecies. This is what was said. They have pierced my hands and my feet in Psalm 22:12. Now this is talking about crucifixion. 1,000 years before crucifixion was even known about. It's pretty weighty evidence. And then we have the authentication by Christ of the Bible. If we look at Matthew 5, 17-18 and Luke 24-44, Jesus clearly validates the Old Testament. Let's have a look at one of those passages. This is what I told you when I was with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. That's the majority of the Old Testament Bible right there. Jesus is saying, it was talking about me. And he was validating it right there. He said to Peter, in Matthew 16, he said to Peter, who do you say I am? And Peter said, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter knew. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. So here we have this Jesus. The Old Testament talks about him coming. God has clearly communicated through the Old Testament about events and things that would happen in the future that are just so accurate, and there's so many of them, and there's so many details that you can't deny that it came from somewhere. I want to propose to you today that it came outside of our time dimension, from where God inhabits eternity. And then he comes so accurately, as it was predicted that he would come, even the time that he would come. And then he says, I'm here. And he says, everything that was written about me was true. And he validates the Old Testament. That's fairly weighty evidence, isn't it? I just want to summarize. We have weight given to us by the manuscripts themselves and the amount of them. We have weight given to us by the amount of time between the originals that were written in the New Testament and the copies that we have. We have the authors who were prepared to die for the story they shared about what they saw. We have unbiased historians who have written about these things clearly, and we have their documents. We have the early church leaders. We have their documents. And you know, and they quoted, as I said, all the different parts of the Bible for their various messages and their teaching. We have archaeology. Try and find archaeological evidence that will speak against what the Bible says. You see, because it was very easy to do that last century or the century before because the evidence wasn't there. But now it's all there. We have the evidence, the validation of God through prophecy that he was coming and he arrived in the form of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And we have God's intervention in history. You know, in my mind, there's just a little bit of stuff there, but it's pretty weighty. I didn't know any of this stuff before I actually made a commitment to God. Didn't know any of it at all. I just had faith because I saw what God was doing in other people's lives. And I recognized that I needed him. That was all I needed at the time. But if you really do the research, and any one of us can do it, it's just at the tip of your fingers. You can find out for yourself that the Bible is absolutely 100% authentic. Now, I'm not saying that every manuscript we've got of the, every manuscript that we've got of the Bible is equal and absolutely 100% the same as every other one. But we have such a weight of evidence that bringing all that stuff together, people who are wise, people who do the research, who can analyze the stuff, can put it together, and we know we've got pretty much the genuine article. That book of Isaiah I spoke about, 75% of the book of Isaiah is a big book. It's a very big book. 75% of it, over 95% accurate. The things that weren't the same didn't affect the story at all. Didn't affect the meaning of the text at all. Not at all. That's pretty weighty evidence. So, I would say to you, if you're still not sure, come and see me afterwards. Do the research yourself. And then you'll be convinced, just as I am. I'm going to pray now. If you want to join me, feel free to. Just by saying amen at the end means you agree. If you don't want to, that's fine. I'll just say, and all the people said, and if you want to, that's great. Join us. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is the word of God, that you've given us so much evidence. Father God, that it's been protected and it's been looked after, so that we have to have faith, Lord, but we have all this other stuff that's there to increase our faith and to make us understand and know you better. So Lord, help us to really nut out what it means to understand your word, to understand what it says to each one of us personally. Don't allow us to miss out on anything that's in there, Lord, because we know it is living and it is active. And it's there for us, and it's written by you. So help us to understand it, I pray, in Jesus' name. And all the people said? Amen. Amen. Hey, let's give a team a big hand for the creative arts, eh?